Hi, welcome back. I'm Bob Stern. I'm a senior metrologist at Agilent Technologies, and this is the second module in the calibration series on calibration adjustments. So I drew this flow chart, which many customers have found to be instructive. Basically, for calibration, what you do is you run a series of performance tests. That, again, is to check the actual performance of the instrument. If you pass, you're done. Calibration is as simple as that. If you don't pass, it means that you need to run adjustments. Once you've run the adjustments, then the appropriate thing to do is to loop back and rerun those performance tests. And if you then pass, you're done. Let's just see how this looks on an actual diagram. Here you see one of our higher performance digital voltmeters, and each dot represents a point over at a different calibration period. And what you can see is that over time it drifts up, and then at the point where it's observed out of specification, we perform an adjustment, and then you'll see that this instrument is then on a new track that it is performing on. Now, whenever we do adjustments at Agilent Technologies, you will receive an as-received report, and then afterwards, you will get an as-completed report. So here you can see that one or more of the tests failed as received. And the reason we give you that report is not only because ISO 17025 requires that we do so, but also we do that so that you can go back and determine, was this instrument far enough out that it could have had an impact on the types of measurements that I'm relying on that instrument? Here's a list of adjustments for one of our higher performance signal analyzers, the X series. What I'd like to call to your attention is that there are 22 performance tests for this. And all of these adjustments correspond to what you would need to run if one of the corresponding performance tests had failed. Just talking a little bit more about performing adjustments, if you haven't thought about this in a while, you may think that this is you open the cover and make some adjustments with some sort of a hand tool. Screwdriver adjustments have essentially disappeared more than 15 years ago in high performance instruments. Nowadays, the adjustments for modern instruments are almost always automated. Frequently, they're iterative, and often they're interactive procedures. In order to get the high performance across an entire measurement band, when we perform adjustments, even the automated procedures sometimes will run for more than an hour. But when it's all over, then you have that instrument tuned up the way that we do them at the factory. If you ran the performance tests and you didn't pass, and you then ran the appropriate adjustments and those were not successful, that means that your instrument is broken. So now we're over in the right-hand part of the diagram. So what we then have to do is diagnose and figure out which parts are broken. Obviously, you have to install them. And then the first thing, once you reinstall them, almost always, is to then run the adjustments. Now you loop back through the diagram, you run the performance tests for the instrument, you've put the new part in, you've made the adjustments, you've run the performance tests so that the instrument is repaired and it's calibrated, and now it's ready for use for another time period until it's ready for calibration again. Here's a photo of our parts center in Roseville, California. We keep over 20,000 different line items, and this is a trade-free zone. We can bring instruments in, we can bring parts in, get them to the instruments very quickly. We also have similar parts depots like this one in Germany and another one in Singapore. Why do we need so many parts there in one location? Well, it really comes down to when the gentleman on the bench here, when he selects a part that he needs to repair an instrument, that part is available less than 20 minutes after he makes that selection. This is how you can see that having that parts depot really allows us to give you the throughput that you're looking for when your instrument needs to be repaired. I want to mention one note that just that you should be aware. If you're doing your calibration business with a company other than Agilent, for the most part, they do not have access to our adjustments. If they make a measurement and discover that an instrument is out of specification, then normally what happens is they have to send it to Agilent. Many of the times when we receive instruments from outside parties, all we have to do is run the adjustments. If this is something that you'd like to understand a little bit better, if you contact one of our support field engineers, give them the serial number and the model number of a particular instrument, and they can look up to see if that instrument was sent to us for a service event. We have some literature on this. You can click the little purple button there on the side and go to this. Again, we really appreciate your interest in calibration, and I'd like to encourage you to view measurement uncertainties. Thank you.